Are you frustrated, anxious, feel life has no purpose? The Bible makes it very clear that where there's no vision, the people perish. Look for it yourself in Proverbs 29:18. Where there's no vision, the people perish. We stumble around without direction. There's an emptiness in our soul. We keep wondering, why am I here, Almighty God? God has a vision for you. And as we look to His Word together, we're going to discover what that vision could be at this particular time. We're going to take a look at how does one actually get a vision, and how do we implement that vision in such a way that we can make a profound difference in the world we live in. God's Word gives us that direction. It's absolutely critical that we stop stumbling through life without a vision and come to the One who can give us that vision, both now and for all eternity. Jesus, our resurrected Lord and Savior, says in Matthew chapter 11, verse 28, "Come to me, all you who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. I'll give you rest in your soul. I'll give you a vision," He says, if we just come to Him. And without a vision, all of life becomes a ceaseless struggle in which we carry one burden after another. And it just begins to push us down further and further. And when we take a look at Luke chapter 14, verse 21, we see that Jesus has come to set the captives free. Yes, where there's no vision, the people perish, stumbling around in darkness. But He gives us that opportunity to come to the light, in which we begin to experience His power, His purpose. You say, well, I've come to the Lord before, but I still don't feel I have much vision. That's why we want to continue to dig into God's Word. We want to see how we can receive that vision from Him and how He can do through us exceedingly beyond what we can even ask or think. A life surrendered to Christ, where Jesus becomes a light, filling us, empowering us, helping us to see a vision both now and for all eternity, is a life of hope and direction. It's a life with meaning and purpose, knowing that with God, as Romans 8:28 says, all things work together for good to them who love God and are called according to His purpose. So we want to begin to move that way. And as we seek God and search His Word, we want to see how we can receive a vision, how we can implement that vision, and how we can truly be more than conquerors through Christ who strengthens us. And that's why we need to continue to get into the Word of God. Now, when you take a look at the prophets in the Old Testament, you see that they were men and women of vision, people that had a vision that came from looking around, seeing the circumstances in the world in which they lived in, and then at the same time, seeking God, hearing the voice of God, and Jesus said, "My sheep hear my voice, they know me and they follow me," and they began to pursue that vision. Now, in a little bit, I'm going to share with you how I've seen God do that during the last 50 years through the work of New Life Evangelistic Center, and how He can do it through you during the next 50 years if we just surrender to Him and let Him speak to us at this time. So you begin to see the future is not hopeless. All these things we read about in the paper or hear about on television or social media that seems so overwhelming and government is failing so badly, well, instead of expecting government to do it, we need to begin to go to God and experience a vision from Him. How do we respond at such a time like this? A living Lord has something He wants to say to us in the midst of all the hurt and all the dismay and struggle at this time. Something that He said to Jeremiah in Jeremiah 29:11-14. Now listen carefully. He says, "For I know the plans I have for you," and God is speaking to us at this time, just like He spoke to the children of Israel when they were ready to go into exile. He says, "Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you hope and a future." There's your promise for today, right here in Jeremiah 29:11. Let's continue to keep looking at that. "Then you will call on me and come and pray to me, and I will listen to you. You will seek me and find me. When you seek me with all your heart, I'll be found by you, declares the Lord, and will bring you back from captivity." Now, there's one basic underlying vision we should all have, is that all the people that are caught in the captivity of sin, hopelessness, despair, resolved in their heart that they're going to go to hell, or they don't know, they feel call themselves agnostics. So when it comes to name your religion, none. Well, they're caught in all these other world views that are so contrary to the one that's laid out in the Scriptures. Jesus has come to set the captives free. And those of you that have experienced this revolutionary message of Christ Jesus, where it's not only in your head, but it's come into your heart, recognize that He's given us that tremendous opportunity to go forth into the world. He says, "Go ye therefore into all the world and preach the gospel, teaching them to observe all things what I've given you," He said. He said, "Go and share and let people know that there's hope. Christ is truly risen." It changes everything. You are a person uniquely and wonderfully made. God has made you for this hour and this time. We see that in the Scripture. And so we come to Him and we let Him speak to us. As we surrender our lives to Him, He plants a vision within our heart. Proverbs 16:3 in the Amplified Bible says, "Roll your works upon the Lord, commit and trust Him wholly to Him. He will cause your thoughts to become agreeable to His will, and so your plans be established and succeed." Wow. What a mighty God we serve. And He desires to show us His plans at this hour. They saw that in Acts chapter 2, verse 17, that they actually were quoting from the book of Joel when Peter said, "In the last days it shall be, says God, that I'll pour out my spirit on all flesh. Your sons and daughters shall prophesy. Your young men shall see visions, and your old men dream dreams." So don't be surprised as you get older that you start dreaming some dreams. Yes, but a vision is something more than just you see or you transferred from here to just some supernatural realm. A vision is also something God plants within our heart. Frequently it's referred to as a mission statement. But how do we develop that? We don't just sit down and write it out someday. We ask the Lord to open our eyes, move us out of darkness into the light of our resurrected Christ, where we can begin to analyze and see the problems that are all around us at this particular time. And then we seek God for a vision. Yes, we seek God for direction. Now, we can judge the visions, the prophecies, the dreams that people come and say, "Oh, God gave me this." Well, is it based upon the Word of God? If not, it's not from God. And what about their lives? Do they demonstrate the fruits of the Spirit? Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, endurance, and self-control? Or is it just a real judgmental message they feel they're going to get from God, that they're going to come down and, try to get you to all but riot? Now, something's wrong with all of that. That's not of God. The vision from God is the one that manifests the fruits of the Spirit and one that enables you to discern the times and one to be able to move forth by faith in the power of God. Jesus desires to work in our lives in a very special way. When we move into His light, we want to share that light with those that are stumbling around in darkness. And that's why He tells us in Matthew 5:16 when He says, "Let your light so shine before men and women, they may see your good works and glorify our Father who's in heaven." So in order to let our light shine before men and women, we need to do what Micah tells us in Micah chapter 6:8, where he says, "He has told you what is good, and what does the Lord require of you, but to do justice, to love kindness, and to walk humbly with your God." So when you start doing justice and kindness, and the world starts praising you, sometimes they'll praise you, and sometimes they want to crucify you, but either way, walk humbly before God. Why? Because you see that it is God who's planted the vision within you and directs you. Now, when He tells us to do justly and treat people fairly and don't take advantage of the weak, we're told to be a people of mercy and kindness and loving, and let our light shine, and that God might work in us and through us. Now, the history of New Life Evangelistic Center is a story of people seeking God's direction in the midst of what may seem like overwhelming needs. In the 1970s, it was the crisis of homelessness. You didn't have government programs that were really out there. So as we sought God in a very special, powerful way, we joined groups that have been doing this for a long time. They continue to do their work, the Salvation Army and the local rescue missions. Well, as time went on, we saw that their doors weren't open like that, because they got into other programs, they didn't have a room to handle them all. So we began to open up first our home at 2107 Park, and then we expanded to 1411 Locust Street, and then centers all over Mid-America. Not only giving the homeless a place to stay, but reading the Word of God, catching a vision to how to help set those caught in the cycle of homelessness free through various training programs and farms and the like. In addition to that, is a true track direction God had given us. The one was the compassion, direct work. The other one was more of a prophetic one, where we were willing to confront those principalities and powers that were contributing to the issue of homelessness, and that involved even having rallies and sleeping outside of the city hall, walking to Jefferson City, and many things like that. Well, in the 1980s, the Lord, as we sought God, so many people having the utility shut off. So many people having the utility shut off. He gave us the vision for dollar help. And actually, dollar help spells out helping elderly and low-income people. That's how the Lord spelled it out to us. And we submitted a proposal to the various utilities. Luckily, Gas took it. They developed their program. Union Electric followed it with their Dollar More program, and people adding a dollar to their gas bills. And they supplemented what HDC was distributing, and many people were helped in that way. But we had to seek God, and these things seemed so overwhelming. And a vision He implanted in our heart for Christian television. And until we saw Channel 24 come forth, and Channel 25 then, and then a series of Christian radio stations. And not only broadcasting the Word of God, but also in these different communities, setting up free stores and direct help centers and training the homeless to do this work. So again, you see a problem, you see a need, it's on your heart so heavy. Maybe you say, I don't see any problems or needs. Well, look around. 90 municipalities in St. Louis County, not a single walk-in shelter. Isn't there a tremendous need for shelter, walk-in training in St. Louis County? Well, in the city, yes, New Life Evangelistic Center at 1411 Locust is closed, sought God, prayed, he put us out on the streets. But in the meantime, that prophetic work of actually standing up to the principalities and powers and praying caused a whole lot of other activities take place, the direct help programs in the city of St. Louis that you don't find in St. Louis County. You don't find over in Illinois. And so we need people of God who are going to raise up, engage in direct prophetic work, because today it's often harder to just open a shelter because the principalities and powers don't want that to happen. They want to leave the people out there to get destroyed bit by bit. And we have to not only play church, but be church and give a vision. And then we saw, for example, on August 20th, 1991, as of that point in the year, 157 people had been murdered in the city. Now, it's easy when you hear about this great murder rate taking place to just feel totally helpless. We got down and sought God. We prayed. We said, Lord, give us a vision. And what did he do? He began to stir in our heart and showed us, we called together teachers and brought experts from out of town to come in and teach these teachers on how to have classes so that they could reconcile students in a nonviolent way, reconciliation. We started engaging in what we refer to as a gun buyback program. We gave people help on the utilities if they brought in their old guns and stuff. Why? Because the streets were flooded with guns. The police department followed that with its own program, became a national program. And of course, we went over, I think at that time it was Mayor Schemel's house, and demonstrated, put crosses out with the names of each one that had died, and tried and get the city leaders to recognize that we have a real crisis here. Well, time has passed, and here we are back again. Violence on the streets. We need to get down before God, seek him, and ask him to give us that direction that we need. There's so many other things that, you know, people, utilities being shut off. I mentioned Dollar Help. There's also the world of renewable energy began to lead us into. And they're like, so I just share that as an example, because there's so much more that we need to do at this time. It seems like the whole issue of COVID-19. Yes, I believe people need to social distance, wear a mask, get their vaccine, but that's not, if you start making that the God and the solution, along comes another form of virus, another one. How many booster shots you got to get? When will he say, my people who call by my name will turn from their wicked ways, I'll hear from heaven, and I will heal their land? Where's the multiple call, the great call for prayer? I mentioned a murder crisis back in the 1990. Well, we had thousands of people also praying at that time. And that's why we saw a murder-free week. God is the one we've got to call on. And all these things that are being done, we walk humbly with our God. We have to really strive to do that. And we have to point people to him. Remember what he said? That they might see your good works and glorify your Father who is in heaven. That God will be glorified. It all comes under the term of evangelism. And as we move into the future, we continue. And maybe we don't see the vision unfold right away. So here's Habakkuk chapter 2, verse 2. And the Lord answered me, write the vision, make it plain on tablets, that he who reads it may run. You see, we're the spark plugs at this particular time, the spark plugs that are willing to trust God, know that visions come from him, that he is our vision, he's our inheritance, he's our hope. And as Hebrews chapter 1, 11 says, faith, what do we do? Faith, we find that faith is a confidence of what we hope for and the assurance about what we do not see. And also it says in scripture that faith comes by hearing and hearing by the word of God. So faith is what we stand on, faith in the living God. Jesus is our vision. We first get into him. We let his power flow upon us. He begins to give us insight on various problems. And then through it all, we're able to proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ to individuals as we try to help them on the true track system. One, direct compassion. Two, the prophetic vision of declaring, repent, the kingdom of God is at hand, confronting principalities and powers, waking up, being a light in this community, all stemming from the vision of our resurrected Lord, for truly he is our Lord. It's time for us to come out of the woods, so to speak, or out of the darkness and hopelessness. It's time for us as members of the body of Christ, not just to be a tail light as we move through life, so to speak, like you find on a car, but to be a headlight. And as a headlight, yes, you'll hit more bugs and all kinds of things, but you're not going to track what the world has to say. You're going to let God give you that guidance and direction and love. They'll know we are Christians by our love. That's why I have so much trouble with those that want to hold up their Jesus signs and raid the Capitol, or those that, in the name of Jesus, will just go and do this vicious, hard things. We have to love and pray for those that we may directly confront in the midst of our prophetic roles of implementing a vision. We have to pray that all men and women will come to know the risen Christ. We have to pray for those that are in leadership, that they might come to know Christ. Yes, they might. We don't have to just keep going along with things they're saying, but yes, we need to pray for them, for the president, the governor, the mayor. We may differ with them on policies, but pray for them. Stop cutting them to shreds. Pray for them. Have a vision. Look at what God did through Daniel when he came up against some ruthless leaders. He's carried into exile. How God used him in the life of Nebuchadnezzar, even the prophetic words of Belshazzar, and all just continued a king after king as different kingdoms even came into being. It was Daniel on the front lines until the Lord gave him that ultimate vision, following his prayer of confession, as he took upon himself the sins of the people and confessed sin that they had committed, and God began to prepare him and used Daniel to prepare the people to return to the promised land. You and I can be the Daniels of this age. You and I can let Christ's light and love flow in us and through us as we allow him to work in us. Now, as we see all these problems, hurts, and needs, if we take them on ourselves and we're not plugged into Christ, our vision, our hope, our King, our inheritance, if we're not plugged into him and we somehow get unplugged through ego, pride, or disillusionment, or frustration, the vision hasn't come into being, we're going to be like a refrigerator that rots on the inside. We have to stay plugged in to the living God. Yes, that's where we find our strength to continue on. Believers with vision know that what Ephesians 3:20 says, that Christ is able to do exceedingly abundantly beyond all we can ask or imagine according to the power that works in us. So we need that power working in us. And he's moved forth by faith. Let that vision, the Holy Spirit, the Holy Spirit put that vision on us. We must believe God when he tells us in Isaiah 41:10, "Do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. I will help you. Yes, I will strengthen you. I will help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand." That's who he is, a mighty God. He'll strengthen us. He'll uphold us. When I find the Lord laying on my heart to move into an area that I've never moved in before, I've got to call upon him. I have to let him strengthen me. I remember Johnny Lee Wilson, a young man, a mentally retarded young man. He was featured on ABC News, and I think I saw a story like in April or May, and I told God, if he's still there in September, I'm just going to stop eating until he gets out. Sure enough, there he was in September. The Lord had me go on a long fast. I didn't know what was going to happen, but the Holy Spirit moved the governor's heart, and Johnny Lee got out because the story I saw in April, the actual murder was in Kansas, and he'd confessed to that murder, but Johnny Lee still held there. But then the Lord opened that up once he got out to the whole Cry Justice ministry, so we were able to proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ in word and deed to prisoners when they're hauled off to Texas to get down before God and cry out to him and pray. And then a miraculous chain of events took place, and they were brought back. I mean, just one miracle after another through the ages. Now, God's got a special work he wants to do in your life. When I say seek him for the vision, perhaps to sum it up, saying, let's find what his will is for our lives. And that becomes that vision inside. If you don't see a vision fulfilled immediately, let's go back to Habakkuk 2:2-3. He says, "Then the Lord replied, write down the revelation, make it plain on tablets, so that a herald may run with it. For the revelation awaits an appointed time. It speaks of the end and will not prove false. Though it linger, wait for it. It will certainly come and will not delay." So there we are. 1411 locust, April 2017, locked out of the building. Lord thrust us out on the streets. We're seeing souls saved out there. We're seeing the work expand in the Overland area. We're seeing it expand in Springfield and New Bloomfield and Marshfield and other places. But we wait. We seek God. And we see how the architectural plans are approved. And then we start seeing God just begin to move and open doors. But it takes years, so we've had to wait. It's hard to wait. I'm hating the waiting a lot. But hey, I find the strength in God because God's presence is the oxygen for the vision that I breathe. It's God's presence. You know, I don't disregard what God is doing, in the little things. They're small beginnings, but he will bring it to fruition. Isaiah 42:3-4, back to the Message Bible. He won't brush aside the bruised and the hurt. Again, we don't want to do that. We want to let God work through us. And he won't disregard the small and insignificant, but he will steadily and firmly set things right. He won't tire out and quit. He won't be stopped until he's finished his work to set things right on earth. And he wants to work through you. God has a purpose for your life. Instead of getting depressed over the stuff that's heavy in your heart, start praying about it. Get into God's Word and let the Holy Spirit wake you up. And when He gives you a plan, a vision, write it down and begin to step out and do it. In the midst of this hurting world, we're children of God. And we need to do God's will. And He's promised He'll fill us with wisdom, understanding, and vision for change. Colossians 1:9 tells us, "For this reason we also, since the day we heard it, do not cease to pray for you and to ask that you may be filled with the knowledge of His will and all wisdom and spiritual understanding." We can be a people of vision, a people that know that God will intervene in the affairs of men and women. Prayer brings this intervention. That's why we got to pray without ceasing. Prayer has been the lifeblood of the work of the New Life Evangelistic Center. It intervenes with judgment, salvation, and deliverance in the midst of most hopeless circumstances. Our prayers at this hour need to be, as Isaiah 64:1 says, "Oh, that you would rent the heavens and come down, that the mountains may shake at your presence." Thank you, Jesus. This isn't a time for you and I to despair. We must begin to earnestly pray, intercede, weep, seek God, and then begin to enlighten, encourage, and have vision, repair, evangelize, and challenge. There's a world dying out there. People falling into a Christless eternity. They need to see our good works and glorify our Father who's in heaven. We let your light so shine before men and women. And share in hope and deed. That don't mean you run out and proselyze somebody and beat them over the head. No, they got to see it in and through each and every one of us. For God declares in Jeremiah 29:11. Remember, He says, "I know the plans I have for you, plans to prosper you." That don't mean just a lot of money. That means your soul is alive and visions unfolding. Not to harm you, plans to give you hope and a future. I mentioned that earlier. Let's let it get in our soul. The Word of God further promises in Psalm 84:11. What does He say? "For the Lord God is a sun and a shield. The Lord bestows grace, favor, and glory. No good thing will He withhold from those who walk uprightly. But first the kingdom of God, all these things shall be added unto you." Jesus has told us in Matthew 5:13-16 that you and I are salt and light. Let's do it. There's no greater vision to have than to see the lost saved, both now and for all eternity. And with this vision burning in our hearts, let's go forth. As Romans 8:37 declares, that we are more than conquerors through Christ who strengthens us. So Lord, with that promise and that declaration of mind, we come before you, Almighty God, knowing that we're more than conquerors. Lord, please forgive us for all the times we saw ourselves as victims rather than victors. All the times we ran to the phone to complain about something rather than a throne of grace to call upon you. Have mercy on us, Lord, at this hour. And Father God, we come before you. We see the hurt. We see the pain. We see the people suffering that are homeless throughout St. Louis County and Illinois. We're seeking you for vision, dear God. We see the increase in violence. We're looking to you for answers. We see the lost. We're coming to you for people to be saved, Almighty God. You're a great God. Let the power of the Holy Spirit come upon us, the anointing from on high, as we go forth as a people of vision. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
As Reverend Larry Rice and the staff of NLEC ask Jesus Christ to strengthen them through the power of the Holy Spirit, you also can do the same. If you've never committed your life to Jesus Christ, you can do that now. Just ask Him to forgive you for all of your sins and to be your Lord and Savior.